Thank you. Good evening. My name is Tony Sheppard, and on behalf of the Departments of Dance, Music, and Theater, I welcome you to the Rite event at Williams College. We are marking a historic occasion, the centennial of the premiere of The Rite of Spring. That May 29th, 1913 performance of this ballet in Paris may be the most legendary premiere in all European music and dance history. Many members of the audience and performers reported that the Rite provoked a riot, screaming, fighting, throwing things. It doesn't matter much what really happened at the riot or whether it was the music or the dance that proved most provoking. What matters is that everyone talked about the event long after it took place, and everyone who was anyone claimed to have been there. The impact of the Rite continues to ripple throughout the performing arts today. In nearly every way, the music, choreography, costumes, and stage design thwarted the expectations of that first audience. The scenario of the ballet was not at all romantic. No love interest, no fairies, no beautiful swans. Instead, imagined ancient rituals culminating in a human sacrifice were depicted on the stage. The choreography did not look like a ballet. Instead of dancing on point, the dancers stomped flat-footed and jerked their arms and heads convulsively. Instead of wearing tutus, ballerinas were dressed in vaguely Native American attire, and some of the male dancers wore animal hides. Instead of lyrical tonal music in late romantic style, the score features sections of aggressive, dissonant, and headbanging music, as well as sections of delicate mystery evoking an ancient culture that never existed. The Rite of Spring continues to shock and surprise its audiences 100 years later. This weekend, we are also celebrating an unprecedented collaboration between the three performing arts departments at Williams here in the 62 Center. Tonight, you will witness excerpts from the dance department faculty's original choreography of the Rite, and later, the Berkshire Symphony's full performance of the score. This performance opportunity is one our student musicians, dancers, and actors are unlikely ever to forget. I'd like to thank the many students, faculty, and staff from all three departments who have made this complex and extraordinary event possible. Now, of course, you likely already knew our Rite event marked the centennial of the work and that it resulted from a fantastic interdisciplinary collaboration at Williams. What you might not have known is that 2013 also marks a milestone in my personal relationship with the Rite. For when I was 13 years old, my clarinet teacher gave me this very LP recording of the Rite of Spring. When I first listened to the record, I knew once and for all that my clarinet teacher was one weird guy. I really didn't know what to make of it. However, I soon began an intense 3-decade-long, you do the math, listening career with the Rite of Spring. As a teenager, I would often stand in front of my record player, watching myself in the mirror, as I attempted to conduct the work. I knew the Rite only as an extremely exciting piece of orchestral music, my own alternative to the heavy metal that my friends enjoyed. The album liner notes outlined the sacrificial scenario and briefly mentioned that the Rite was originally a ballet, but the jacket offered no pictures of the dance, no description of the choreography and its relationship to the music. Indeed, in his notes, the conductor Pierre Boulez states, quote, "As to the composition itself, it does not depend on the argument of a ballet, and that is why it has no need of any modification in passing from the theater to the concert hall." Great, so I wasn't missing anything. The unwary consumer was thus reassured that nothing was lost by stripping the dance from the Rite. This view, of course, entirely ignores the work's long cultural history. The 1913 Rite of Spring production was, like our 2013 event today, a truly collaborative work. The Ballet Russe, the Russian ballet, had begun performing in Paris in 1909 and featured productions set in exotic lands, including Russia, and often involving flamboyant costumes and sets and more than a hint of eroticism. They were the Cirque du Soleil of ballet, and the French could not get enough of these wild and provocative Russians. The Rite of Spring became their most historically significant and notorious production, even though, or perhaps because, it was met with intense audience hostility and critical controversy. The Ballet Russe was led by one Sergei Diaghilev, an incomparable impresario who managed repeatedly to bring together the most creative figures in Europe from 1909 to 1929. Stravinsky, Ravel, Prokofiev, Debussy, Milhaud, Satie, and Poulenc composed for it. Fokine, Nijinsky, Messiaen, and Balanchine choreographed numerous works, and artists such as Picasso designed sets and costumes. Diaghilev, by the way, couldn't compose, conduct, or choreograph, but he was an absolutely central figure to European modernism. Igor Stravinsky had composed several successful ballets before proposing the Rite to Diaghilev. Stravinsky initially took credit for devising the ballet's scenario and stated on the day of the premiere, "I wished to express the sublime uprising of nature renewing herself, the whole pantheistic uprising of the universal harvest." Now, the ballet doesn't really tell a story at all, but offers a pageant of imagined scenes from prehistoric Russian life, rituals of spring and renewal that climax in the sacrifice of a chosen maiden who dances herself to death. This is a rather different musical depiction of springtime than offered by earlier composers. Stravinsky's music expresses the violence of growth, the forceful bursting forth of life in the spring, the cracking of our frozen ground. Birth is not gentle, and yet I do hear something like the twittering of birds in the murky introduction section. The sets and costumes for the ballet were designed by the rather mystical painter and amateur archaeologist Nicholas Rorik. Rorik was particularly interested in the ancient Scythians of southern Russia. However, his costume designs seem more influenced by his encounters with the popular Wild West shows that toured in Europe. In its choreography, music, and design, the Rite of Spring perfectly exemplifies the primitivist imagination run wild. Now, why was the Rite such a revolutionary musical work? Answering that question could take us all night, but I want to at least touch on a few of the astonishing musical features of this score. Many composers in the early 20th century explored new approaches to harmony, constructing new chords and employing alternative scales to the standard major and minor. Stravinsky's approach to pitch in the Rite exemplifies this revolutionary spirit in modernist music. For instance, throughout the Augurs of Spring section, we hear a very interesting chord. Part of the orchestra plays an F flat major chord, a perfectly fine chord that you might hear any day of the week. But the other part of the orchestra is playing a seventh chord on E flat. A bit spicier, but still within our shared musical experience. However, these chords are actually heard simultaneously in augurs in an exhibition of bitonality, or perhaps Stravinsky's interest in octatonicism. Now that is a juicy chord. It's one you can sink your teeth into, and it's one that bites you back. In fact, the reason this chord bites so keenly is that it is struck some 212 times in this section. I counted. In a powerful ostinato with bold, unexpected accents placed deliberately to disrupt our expectations. And here is kind of sort of what that sounds like. And here is that chord played in its full orchestral glory. Thank you. melodies also disrupt our expectations. His tunes seem to be composed of fragments, reshuffled without clear pattern or order, creating a musical collage. For example, the music theorist Robert Morgan noted this approach to melodic composition in a prominent flute melody in the Augers of Spring section. And here's that tune. This tune seems to be composed of five fragments or cells that are ordered in such a way that as soon as we begin to sense a pattern, the pattern is avoided by Stravinsky. We can label these five fragments A, B, C, D, E to point out the surprising successions. And here we go. A, B, C, D, B, E, B, C, A, B, C, D, B, C, D, B, E, B, E, B, C, D. Some scholars have sensed a parallel between Stravinsky's melodic style and Picasso's cubism. The unexpected juxtaposition of musical fragments also occurs between larger blocks of musical material. Let's hear that flute tune now within a section of the augers that really builds up a thick and layered musical texture of contrasting lines and juxtaposed blocks of music. When I was 13, the section of the rite that I found most challenging to conduct alone in my bedroom was the sacrificial dance. Throughout the rite, Stravinsky changes meter frequently and occasionally has different sections of the orchestra playing in different meters or different repeated rhythmic patterns layered on top of each other, chugging away in their own musical world. In the sacrificial dance section, meter changes almost every measure. 1, 2, 3, pause. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Again, he deliberately avoids a pattern. Just when you think you feel a pattern and can anticipate the next meter, he switches it up on you. Here's the start of that passage so that we can all try to conduct this together. Arms up, everyone. I guess we'll just have to leave the conducting to Maestro Feldman this evening. A good deal of the rite is energizing, aggressive, and powerful music. And yet, the score also contains passages of exceptional beauty and subtle mystery, very quiet passages in the Rite of Spring. One passage is particularly striking to me, and in the original ballet by Nijinsky was matched by three stately women entering the stage on point. The musicologist Richard Taruskin discovered several decades ago that this melody and multiple others in the score were derived by Stravinsky from Russian folk music. This facsimile of Stravinsky's sketchbook reveals a melody jotted down by the composer way at the top, as though he had copied it from something else, another source. Here's that tune. Thank you. Don't worry, I'm going to leave the rest of the piano playing to Elizabeth Wright and Doris Stevenson this evening. Taruskin identified this as a Russian folk melody, and Stravinsky set this melody in the Rite for a small E-flat clarinet and bass clarinet. Here is its orchestral setting. Just as Rorick turned to Native American models for his designs representing prehistoric people in the Rite of Spring, Stravinsky turned to the living music of Russian peasants for similar representational purposes. The original choreography of the Rite was certainly as revolutionary as the music and contributed dramatically to the work's primitivist aesthetic. Vaslav Nijinsky had already shocked the public with his choreography and dancing in the 1912 Afternoon of a Faun. He had appeared earlier as the title character in Stravinsky's Petrushka. Nijinsky was one of the most scandalous and beloved figures in the dance world, both on and off the stage, in the early 20th century. His choreography for the Rite breaks the rules of classical ballet. He called upon some of the most highly trained ballet dancers in history and asked them to stomp on the ground, hunch over, throw themselves to the floor, and jerk convulsively all over the stage. Rather than be intimidated by the complexity of Stravinsky's score, Nijinsky embraced it, attempting to reproduce every rhythm and every violent accent. His choreography actually added new rhythms, and in some sections, the dancers add percussive sounds by stamping or slapping. The dance is tied exceptionally tightly to the music in numerous ways. Groups of instruments are paralleled by different groups of dancers. A new musical theme is matched by the entrance of a new group of dancers, and the return of a theme frequently prompts a return of the same choreography. This is all exemplified by Nijinsky's choreography to the Augurs of Spring section, seen here in a reconstruction by the Joffrey Ballet. After the premiere, Stravinsky tried to distance himself from the score from the ballet, arguing that the music stood alone and wasn't connected to the dance. However, during the creation of the ballet, Stravinsky actually participated directly in creating the choreography. The piano score used during the rehearsals reveals that Stravinsky even suggested specific dance movements. For example, in the Augurs section we just saw, Stravinsky called for dance accents that would not match the music accents, but would instead emphasize the meter. And this is exactly what Nijinsky had his dancers do from the waist down, right? One and two and one and... Okay, I'll leave the dancing to the dancers also. For another passage in the sections, in this section, Stravinsky called for the dancers to move in triple meter, 1, 2, 3, while the music continued in duple, 1, 2, 1, 2. I will count out the triple meter that the swaying maidens engage in while we hear the orchestra remain in duple meter. In yet another section of the work, Stravinsky called for, quote, trampling with each eighth note. Do not attempt to count the measures. And Nijinsky followed this direction precisely. This and other detailed evidence clearly reveals that choreography and music were inseparable at the creation of the rite. Stravinsky's Rite of Spring has attracted choreographers ever since Nijinsky. In 1920, Messiaen created new choreography for the Ballet Russe, and Martha Graham danced in this production in 1930 before going on to create her own version in 1984. The list of choreographers who have tackled this score reads like a who's who of modern dance. Lester Horton, Mary Wigman, Maurice Béjart, Pina Bausch, Paul Taylor, etc. By 1992, over 70 different choreographers had created versions of the rite, and new choreography continues to be created today. Indeed, Williams dance faculty members have been creating original choreography to Stravinsky's score throughout this academic year. Tonight, 9 performers from Williams Dance Department ensembles will perform 3 excerpts choreographed by Janine Parker, Erica Dankmeyer, and Nian Love. I would like to invite members of the music department, Elizabeth Wright and Doris Stevenson, to the stage to perform these excerpts from Stravinsky's version for 2 pianos. The first excerpt begins just before the Augurs of Spring section. Notice how rather than stamping away on each eighth note as in the Nijinsky, a greater degree of tension is created by building sustained dance movements. The tension escalates as the dancers rise from the stage. Some of the dance gestures are clearly connected to musical gestures, and yet the dance is not enslaved to the music. In fact, some dance gestures anticipate or continue past the musical gestures they are tied to. For instance, there's this arms above the head shake gesture that's tied to the music, but then continues past the music. There's also a leaping gazelle-like movement that anticipates the bouncing, leaping musical gesture that follows. That mysterious Russian folk melody that I played earlier and showed on the screen from the sketchbook will be matched by mysterious movement as the dancers stand in a line holding hands and then gently interweave their own line in a gesture of consolation and momentary peace. A carried body in this excerpt perhaps suggests a sacrifice to come. May we have the first excerpt? The second excerpt presents the Dance of the Earth section and includes some rather ominous silence. We will see a mass of dancers moving as one, a nervous, menacing creature that then splits atomically into individual dancers as though sparked by the music. The image of carried fallen bodies recurs, and this excerpt actually blurs the boundaries between parts one and two of the score. The dancers seem to form a human bridge at this musical juncture.
Thank you.
In the final excerpt, we hear the naming and honoring of the chosen one section, and the dancers explode with energy and assume a percussive role, stomping the stage as a drum. I find the selection of the chosen one in this dance simultaneously quite frightening and wonderfully witty. I invite you to return to the 62 Center in May, when Elizabeth Wright and Doris Stevenson will again join members of the dance department ensembles to perform a full-length Rite of Spring choreographed by our own dance faculty. I hope that spring will finally have arrived in the Berkshires by that point. Nijinsky's choreography was tossed out after the premiere, but as I said, modern choreographers have never abandoned the Rite. The music never vanished, but instead became one of the most influential works in the history of European music. A great number of composers and musical styles in both art and popular music history have been influenced by this work. The Rite has also turned up in some unexpected places, in forms that I believe have strongly shaped its reception and our understanding of modern music more generally. By far, the most famous form of the Rite appeared in Walt Disney's 1940 animated film, Fantasia. Disney superimposed an educational narrative onto the Rite, visualizing the work as a pageant of the rise of all life on Earth. They reworked the score a good deal, and it seems as though Stravinsky had composed to the film instead of the other way around. Actually, Stravinsky's style is itself rather cinematic, alternating between blocks of contrasting musical material, different sets of instruments, employing collage techniques, perfect for film, for cutting between shots of different characters or settings. In our first clip from Fantasia, we will hear the Augurs of Spring section. The cinematic rhythms, both within the frame and between shots, resemble Nijinsky's choreography in that each musical accent is responded to visually. The music appears to choreograph the belching volcanoes. But like the new dance department choreography we saw, the film actually achieves great intensity by ignoring the relentless underlying eighth note pulse and instead smoothly and inexorably zooming in. The film also brings out different features of the music for me. For example, swirling smoke and fire from the volcanoes makes me focus more on the circular string and woodwind melodic lines.
Mm-hmm.
A bit further along in evolutionary history, in Fantasia, we encounter an epic battle between a T-Rex and a Stegosaurus, cinematically choreographed to the naming and honoring of the Chosen One section. Spoiler alert, the Stegosaurus is going to serve as the sacrificial victim. These dinosaurs move in ways very similar to how Stravinsky indicated the dancers should move in relationship to the music. Simply put, these dinos really know how to dance. That's the downer moment for this evening's presentation, I'm afraid. We will now turn from paleontology to political economy. Perhaps the most strange and disturbing appearances of the music of the Rite are found in World War II propaganda films made by the US government in the years following Disney's Fantasia. Stravinsky's score was repeatedly employed to accompany scenes of Japanese soldiers brutally fighting in China. Most bizarrely, the Rite is heard in a section of the propaganda film Know Your Enemy, Japan, focused on Japan's trade wars and militant industrialization in the 1930s. First, we will hear the entire naming and honoring of the Chosen One section, as we are told about Japan's unfair trade practices and piracy of American and European products. The music then immediately jumps to the Dance of the Earth section, the final section of part one in the ballet, which is also heard in its entirety. The screen alternates between shots of frantic workers engaged in various forms of manual labor and images of smoothly moving war machines as we build to Stravinsky's musical cliffhanger climax. The sense of increasing frenzy and violence is primarily achieved by the music, and the sequence ends with the sound of explosions that are perceived as the musical conclusion to this passage from the Rite.
From the factories of Osaka, the mills of Tokyo, the chemical plants of Nagoya, the steel mills of Iwata, the shipyards of Nagasaki came the economic bullets. But these belching factories in the cities were not the real machinery behind Japan's trade war. For here was the real machinery. The slums of the cities where 64% of Japan's products were made in small backroom factories employing five people or less. There are hundreds of thousands of these factories in the home where father, mother, and children work in semi-slavery. Taking advantage of these low labor costs, the industrialists of Japan knew they could undersell every other nation on earth, and they did. All over the world, they dumped their cheap labor products. And to their dumping, they added piracy. Countless patented articles were manufactured and sold throughout Asia under their American names. the two best-known American spark plugs. Genuine old Scotch whiskey was made in the distilleries of Osaka. Matches made in Kobe were labeled made in Sweden. They undersold silk to the silk-producing Italians. They undersold England's cotton goods in the home of her own cotton industry. They undersold beer to the beer-producing Germans. American toothbrushes, retailing at 35 to 50 cents each, were copied in Japan to retail in American chain stores at 10 cents each. They even undersold us with our own American flag. And with the money accumulated in foreign countries with these cheap labor exports, did they in turn buy automobiles, iceboxes, or food? Did they erect better homes for the Jap workers or improve their living conditions? No, indeed. Instead, they imported oil, scrap iron, tin, rubber, aluminum, and secretly built up their powerful war machine. A fanatic nation turning its sweat into weapons for conquest. Sweat for guns. Sweat for planes. Sweat for ships. Sweat for war.
My final example is from one of the most prominent operas composed in my lifetime, John Adams's 1987 Nixon in China. In one scene in this opera, President Nixon and Chairman Mao meet in Mao's study. Mao is rather comically echoed and supported throughout the scene by his three female secretaries, who we may refer to as the Maoettes. At the conclusion of their meeting, Mao and Nixon express some degree of admiration for each other. Adams's motoric, minimalist style exhibits the deep and pervasive influence of Stravinsky's score. From the very beginning of this clip, you'll hear that in the background. But in this scene, towards the end, Adams even quotes the Augurs of Spring section, that crunching chord repeated some 212 times by Stravinsky, as the Maoettes lead Mao out, and as Mao himself ruefully declares, "Founders come first, then profiteers." Befitting minimalism's embrace of tonality, Adams's version of that chord is less dissonant than Stravinsky's was. Here, the rite perhaps alludes to the violent, youthful, sacrificial rituals of the Cultural Revolution.
Forgive my bluntness. I'm growing old and soft. I won't demand your overthrow. Your life is known to all. It's a relief to think I may be spared.
I thought you might be overwhelmed.
My feet are firmly planted on the ground like yours. Like you, I take my stand among poor people. We can talk.
Six Crises isn't a bad book.
He reads too much. Who can say? Has study given Chairman Mao an eye and constitution? No! No! Founders come first.
Founders come first.
Then profit.
Then profiteers.
If I had a ticket good for one ride on a time machine, I wouldn't go back to Maoist China. I'd go back to May 29th, 1913 Paris at the Théâtre des Champs-Élysées to experience the premiere of The Rite. Actually, I'd want to be there the night before for the dress rehearsal, which apparently went flawlessly. Multiple eyewitness accounts refer to murmuring starting during the introduction, and then catcalls, whistling, laughter, and wild animal cries once the dance began. The audience broke into factions, those who were enraged and wanted to stop the performance, and those who fought back, demanding that the performers be allowed to continue uninterrupted. Apparently, a woman slapped a man who was hissing, and one dance critic found that the man behind him became so carried away by the score that he unknowingly beat on the critic's head in time with the music. Many performers reported that the dancers soon found it impossible to hear the music at all. At one point, Diaghilev himself begged the audience to allow the performance to continue. However, it seems fairly evident to me that a scandal was exactly what was intended, for the Ballet Russe were always able to push its audience's buttons. The ballet that appeared on the program back in 1913, just before The Rite, was Fauquin's beautiful Les Sylphes, or The Sylphs, to the music of Chopin. During our brief intermission this evening, as we set up for the Berkshire Symphony's performance, we will screen a recording of this ballet as performed by the Bolshoi. Please make sure to return to your seats in about 10 minutes for the Rite of Spring. It's going to be a riot. Thank you very much. Thank you.